Let's go. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, for this morning. We have gathered here in your presence to listen to your word. As we listen, our mind is renewed. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for teaching us today the importance of happy marriage. Most important, Lord, it is you who created Adam and Eve in your likeness and image, and you blessed them and said, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Through the promises, we come to know how to be a good wife, how to be a good husband. Christ is the center of happy married life. Without Christ, that marriage is a chaos. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for teaching us the principles behind a happy married life. Most important, especially those who are longing for children, waiting for a long period of time, a type of friction, misunderstanding, worry. Open up the door for Satan to steal, kill, and destroy. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for teaching us the truth, the mystery behind God's promises for a happy married life. As we are listening to it, our life is completely transformed. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father, for your precious promises. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Praise Jesus. Marita, you can go to one. Brother Joe, you can go to 1 Corinthians chapter 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, 1 to 7. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Lord. 1 to 7. 1 onwards. First chapter, first verse. Praise God. Praise Jesus. The reason I took this topic is few of them, those I do counsel, speaking, helping them to stand on trusting God for the child. I came to know one of the life partner, especially wife, going into stress, going into anxiety, worry, depression. It's not only affecting herself, it is also affecting her spouse. In one case, the wife wants to have child, but she's not happy to have a happy married life. She's not happy with the husband. There are many cases, but the priority for God, who created the marriage institution, is the one who created everything, and he created everything for whom? For man. And he said to man, have dominion over it. And he created men and women in his likeness and in his image. The purpose of God's creation for Adam and Eve was to spread that love. God did not create only Adam, or God did not create only Eve, or Adam, only two Adam or two Eve. It is Adam and Eve in the likeness and the image of God. God is the founder of marriage institution, and God is the center of happy. Without God, if you want to have a happy married life, that is not a happy married life. That is a selfish life, self-centered life. There is business in that life. Praise Jesus. Praise God. Because one particular case, as I was saying about a sister who went into depression, not only she went into depression, she has a very good spouse who's able to understand her. He does not belong to Christianity. He he honors her, respects her. He also has emotions. He also has faced a loss, but he's not verbalizing. It is not, men's nature is not to verbalize. They're internalized. They will think about it. They won't open their mouth and they won't say anything. But women, we open up, and it seems to that women is only undergoing the pain. No, men are also undergoing that with the same pain, the loss of the child, even it is for him. And he is sacrificing himself to counsel her, to be with her, to go with her to the church. But instead of taking care of the husband who's with her, having a happy married life, going into a shell, into depression, completely destroying her life, a spouse life, her health, which is more important. God created Adam and Eve. It is like, where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there in your midst. To be two, one is a strength. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. We have those who are single, not to say that we are single. Then no. We have an unseen partner, the Holy Spirit. No one is left alone. Especially those who are born again believer, we are not all alone. We have an unseen partner. The Holy Spirit is with us always, 24/7. And to have this happy married life, we should know the importance of marriage. And you can also go to Ephesians chapter 5, 22 onwards. You'll know how Christ is the center of happy married life. Christ and church is combined together, will explain how husband and wife should be. But in today's topic, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, I took purposely, want to have a child. To have a child is a blessing. But longing for the child, there is a loss in a happy married life. Frustration, worry, depression, anger towards each other, pointing out each other's physical ailment or something or the other, pointing other, because of you I'm going through this, or because of this I'm going through this. Praise God. If this relationship is strong, if husband and wife are rooted in the word, if husband and wife come together and pray in tongues, and when Christ becomes your first priority, you will not be worried that whether you're having child or not. This healthy relationship will help you to renew your mind. Your health, your physical body is renewed. That will help you to have a blessed children. Instead of going seeking God directly for child, why can't we seek God to have a happy married life first? That partnership, that fellowship, that friendship, and then the fruit is automatic. It is there. Be fruitful, multiply, and replenish the earth. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. So now concerning the things whereof you wrote unto me, it is good for a man not to touch a woman. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let every woman have her own husband. Let the husband render unto the wife due benevolence, means kindness, and likewise also the wife unto the husband. The wife hath not power of her own body, but the husband. And likewise also the husband hath no power of his own body, but the wife. Defraud you not one the other. Defraud you not one the other, except it be with consent for a time, that you may give yourself to fasting and prayer and come together again, that Satan tempt you not for your incontinency. But I can put 1 Corinthians 7, 5 comparison, 5th verse comparison. Do not deprive each other of marital rights, except perhaps by mutual consent for a time, so that you may devote yourself unhindered to prayer, but come together again, so that Satan will not tempt you to sin because of your lack of self-control. Do not refuse and deprive and defraud each other of your due marital right, except perhaps by mutual consent for a time, so that you may devote yourself unhindered to prayer, but afterwards resume marital relationship, lest Satan tempt you to sin through your lack of restoration in sexual desires. Okay, you can remove, you can come back. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'll explain what it is. 5:6. I say therefore to an unmarried, but I speak this by permission and not by commandment. For I would that all men were even as myself, but every man hath proper gift of God. One after this manner, the other after that. 1-5. But I can go back. This fifth verse says that fasting and prayer. And it is said that we know what is of the flesh is flesh, what is of the spirit is spirit. The purpose for happy married life is to spread love, to show love to one to another. To an extreme that I don't belong to me, I belong to you, you belong to me. Denying yourself and prioritizing the other person is the foundation for a happy married life. But when flesh is taking control over, it is not looking into other person's desire, it is looking into his own desire. That is why even that relationship, that intimacy also ends up in selfishness when flesh takes control. And that is why in 1 Corinthians chapter 5:7 it is given to prayer and fast. This unity, this intimacy is not based on selfishness. It's not based on flesh. It is not based on 5 senses. This intimacy is, I am there for you. You are there for me. That intimacy. In order to bring that intimacy, we need to fast and pray. Otherwise, Satan will take control, and which was meant for good, it becomes a self-centered and selfishness. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. And in today morning, I had sent points to have a happy married life. Based on these, this only that points I given. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. So it is more important, whatever we do, even in a happy married life, it is God who created that that interest, that intimacy between a husband and wife, that was created by God. But today Satan has taken rule over that emotion through media, through unwanted movies, unwanted pictures, and it has completely destroyed a happy married life. Praise Jesus. Praise God. That is why 5:5 clearly says, fasting and prayer. One onwards, even the second verse says, nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife and let every woman have her own husband. One onwards, 1 Corinthians chapter 7, 1 onwards. Praise God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now concerning the things whereof we wrote unto me, it's good for a man not touching. Nevertheless, let the husband render the wife due benevolence. Marita, 3, you can put 3 comparison. The husband must fulfill his marital duty of his wife with good will and kindness, and likewise the wife to her husband. It is clearly given good will and kindness, and what is due as if and what is due her as his wife. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. If we want to get much more clear picture of this verse, we need to go to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 onwards. That gives the clear picture. What does a man require? What does the woman require? How Christ is fulfilling the need of the church and how the church is submissive to Christ gives us a clear picture of goodwill and kindness. So it is very clearly said that to have a happy married life without Christ, you cannot have. That marriage is not a happy married life. That marriage is totally depending on the flesh. And that is why when the flesh is not being satisfied, when the other person is not satisfying the other person, today divorce rate has been increased because today marriages are being failed because of self-centeredness and selfishness, only prioritizing their own interest and their own need. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, you can go to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 onwards. Longing for a child for a long period of time and going into a shell of depression, anxiety, worry. Why can't you enjoy the time together and having the time spending together and have a happy married life? That will become a good foundation, not only for your, not only for the spouse, but also that will be a good foundation for the children that we have. Praise God. The 1 Corinthians chapter 7 verse 3 is based on this in this chapter fully. Wives, submit yourself unto your husband as unto the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head and he is the savior of the body. Submit. It is given submit, right? Yeah, we should submit. Only wife can do what is her part. She need to submit. But what is given, what is the role of a husband? As an head, savior of the body. Husband, love your wife even as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it. That is, he might sanctify and cleanse it. Is it happening in today's married life? Is it happening as if the husband is ready to sanctify and cleanse it, or is the wife is ready to be submissive? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. God's word clearly says that head means we already learned this. Head is not to take rulership. Head is not to take authority. Head is not to say that I am the boss, you listen to me. That is not headship. If you want to be a leader, if you need to be a head, means you need to take the responsibility to take care, to love, to provide, to protect. But this verse is completely taken. Christ is not at all his name in the picture. And just taking the one line head, using that one line, how many men are dominating the family, saying that I'm the head of the family, you need to obey to me. They leave away Christ, who was the center of happy married life. Christ has also loved the church and gave himself, sacrificed himself, denied himself, put his flesh to death. You know, he showed us love. And he also cleansified us with his words, with his promises. Only a man who's rooted in the word can have that. This is what is given before coming together, before having that intimate relationship, before having that that intimacy. Prayer and fast means what? Ask the Holy Spirit to give you the strength. The husband shall pour out his love, but that is not there in this case. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm feeling, I want the desire, the needs to me. That's all finished. Is it a happy married life? Is it the basis for having that intimacy with one another? Only the man who's rooted in the word will know that he should, because it is difficult. It is difficult for a man to verbalize and to express his love, but God is giving that. Only a man rooted in the word can express his love, can say it, can speak it out. In the same way, it is given, wife, submit yourself unto your husband. Previous verse 21. Previous verse. Submitting yourself to one another. submit, wife only, not only submit, submit one another, submit yourself one to another in the fear of God. Means Christ should be the center of happy married life. Thank you. We can come back regarding 26, 27. I need to see the wife's part. Submission. It is not easy for a woman to submit. Is it easy for a woman to verbalize, to express her love, to speak out? But it is not easy for her to submit because she's a multitasking in nature. In nature, God has kept. That is why God said, I'll make a help meet. She can be a multitasking person in nature. And God is saying this multitasking woman to be submissive, not to take the upper hand. To submissive to the husband. How the church was submissive. Mata, can come down. 26, 27. That he might sanctify them and magnificent. Okay. So only one husband loves your wife. Every Christ has loved the church and gave himself for it, and he might sanctify it. 29. Okay, only one line is given for that. For this cause shall a man leave. 32, 33, a great mystery that I speak concerning Christ. Okay, thank you. Praise God. So submissive, it is not for a woman too easy to be submissive because of a multitasking. But God is, if God is your center, it is not that it is, that shows not only submissive, when a woman is submissive to God's word, that woman will make the decision to be submissive and to be a helpmeet, not to take authority, not to rule over, but give opinion and suggestion. Also say, this will be the consequences, okay, but decision is yours. You make the decision. It is herself letting her to go down. If God says to be submissive, means, okay, I'll be submissive. As the church was submissive to Christ, without Christ, there is no happy married life. But this concept is taken away. Jesus Christ is not there in a happy married life. Promises are not there. What is happening? Men being selfish, both men and women being selfish and self-centered. When it comes to sexual desires, men will take the upper hand. When it comes to authority and administration of the family, women is taking the upper hand. Totally chaos. It is not according to God's system. Women becomes the rulership and leadership of the house of the family. And men, and this is not what God says. God is clearly say how happy married life should be. If this happy married life is there, you're learning to sacrifice, you're learning to deny, you're learning to allow the other person, you're seeing the prosperity in other person and you're rejoicing. These are the fundamental principles of Christ. As Christ gave himself, Christ was protecting, taking the husband is becoming more responsible, taking the responsibility and giving importance, prioritizing God's word, taking the responsibility to take care of his wife and his children, then not allowing the wife and children to depend on someone else. Only when a person is rooted in the word, that person will become more responsible. If the person is not rooted in the word, and if you expect your husband to be, he should not drink, he should be responsible, he should take care of the need of the family, how come? No, you need to pray for your unsaved loved one, especially for your spouse, to be rooted in the word. When he is rooted in the word, when he comes to learn the word, this word will help him to be a strong man. This word will help him with the help of the Holy Spirit. I can do all things to Christ who strengthens me. When he goes through the scripture, he will understand, he will prioritize, he will think it is my responsibility to take care of my wife and my children, and I whatever work I do, like Abraham, wherever he went, whatever work he did, it was prosperous, it was a blessing. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. And these verses, God is very clear in constructing a happy married life and giving the principle for a married life. But we human completely hand over to Satan, and we human allowing our flesh to dominate and completely destroying the happy married life. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. For no man ever had hated his own flesh, but nourished and cherished it, even as the Lord the church. For we are the member of his body, of his flesh and his bones. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife. They two shall be one flesh. There is a great mystery, but I'm speaking concerning Christ and the church. Nevertheless, every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. 34, is this the last verse? 33, 34. That is the last. Yes. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular so love his wife even as himself. The wife see that she reverence her husband. Wife see that she reverence her husband. But I can put this verse in comparison. When it is clear, if elders also are rooted in the word, they will know the truth, and after their son or daughter got married, they won't interfere into their life. Only when a person is rooted in God's word will know how a Christian life should be. If he's not rooted, he will not know. It is God who created everything. Marriage was an institution, was created by God. But today we follow the world system to have a good married life. When we say it comes to word of God, we are not taking, we can go to a counselor, we go to a psychology, we go to doctors, we have their opinion, their words become greater. But when it comes to God, we question. It will come, it is right or not. Why always being in word, not knowing that everything have to have a happy married life. Bible is by there are set of God has given us the principle. God has given the system. This is how the kingdom works, and follow this principle and your married life will be happy. But we are not interested to look into the Bible. We are not interested to look into the promises, and we are not ready to correct ourselves. But we need our children's life to be happy, my grandchildren's life to be happy, my life to be happy. But we are not interested to tap into the word and look what God's principle is. If elders are so rooted in the word, they themselves will say, it is your choice. If you want, I can help you. I can give you an opinion, but you need to make your decision. You need to make your choice. You need to go and work hard. Whatever might be the work, you need to take the leadership. You need to provide your husband, wife. You need to take care of her. In the same way, the mother of, if the parents are rooted, they'll advise the daughter saying that be submissive. They will advise, be submissive, like the church was submissive to Christ, show love, show respect, honor, reverence. Marit, I can put 33 comparison. Without the word, there is the marriage, they say it is a happy married life, that is not at all a happy married life. We don't know what is going in them, within them. Outside it seems to be rosy, but within them, we don't know whether it is thorny or rosy. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. However, each man among you, without exception, is to love his wife and his every own self. And his very own self with behavior worthy of respect and esteem, always seeking the best for her with an attitude of loving kindness. However, each man among you, without exception, is to love his wife as his own self. If I do not know this verse, how will I love my spouse, not expecting anything, as I love myself? How will I love without knowing this verse? I can't. However, every man among you is to love his wife as his very own self, with behavior worthy of respect and esteem, always seeking the best for her with an attitude of loving kindness. Always, not sometime, always seeking the best for her. If a man is rooted in the word, he will understand what his wife is going through, because he has the anointing of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will help him to look into the other person's need. The man who's rooted in the word will not be selfish and self-centered, not only looking to himself. He will start and prioritizing the needs of his spouse. Even it is the same way for the wife. If she gives priority to God, she will not look into her own need. She will able to look through the lens of Christ, what her husband needs, what her husband desires, and even if it is painful for her, she is ready to sacrifice, because she is a woman who is rooted in the word. Praise God. The best for a husband with the wife with an attitude of loving kindness. And the wife must see to it that she respects and delights in her husband, that she notices him and prefers him and treats him with a loving concern, treasuring him, honoring him, and holding him dear. That she notices him and prefers him, because men will not verbalize, men will not speak what is there in them. If a woman is vigilant, if a woman only when the wife is rooted in the word, she will able to see what is in him. She will able to recognize what is he desiring for, what is his will. Without the root, you will not find out what your husband wants. You cannot. With the help of the Holy Spirit, God will help you to look into the other person's need. That is known as my wife. You don't belong to yourself, you belong to your husband. The husband, you do not belong to yourself, you belong to your wife. God is clear in this marriage institution. That's she respects the light in her husband. That she notices him and prefers him and treats him with a loving concern, treasuring him, honoring him, and holding him dear. 1 Peter 3:2. But I can go there. 1 Peter 3:2, we can see that one also. Amplified, we can go. 1 Peter 3:2. So 1 Peter 3:2. When they see your, no. I'll come first one, amplified. In the same way, you wives, be submissive to your own husband, subordinate, not as an inferior, but out of respect for the responsibility entrusted to the husband and the accountability to God, and so partnering with them, so that even if some do not obey the word of God, they may be won over to Christ without discussion by godly lives of their wife. Hallelujah. Because a wife is ready to submit herself, even she's being multitasking, even she's been, in today's case, even she is highly qualified, even she has 3-4 degrees, even she is a PhD scholar, if she listens to that word, she is making herself submissive and prioritizing her husband, saying that be submissive to your husband, subordinate, not as, it is not inferior, it is not something I'm making myself low so that my husband will exalt. No. God humbled himself. Humble is the basic foundation for a Christian life. The one who is humble, the one who's ready to humble, God will exalt the humble. Jesus, it is the quality of Christ to humble himself. Jesus Christ humbled himself, being the creator, being the former, and he humbled himself and took the form of a servant. You know why? To express his love. When you humble yourself, when you submit yourself, when you be submissive, it shows your character. It reveals Christ in you to your spouse, and your spouse who recognizes Christ, even the spouse is not rooted in the word, can sense Christ in you. And because of your submissive, because of this nature, subordinate, not as inferior, but of respect of the responsibility entrusted to the husband and their accountability to God, and as a partnering with them. allowing him to take the decision. Let his decision be the right, but as a helpmate, as a partner, I can give my opinion, I can give my suggestion, but I cannot command, I cannot authority, I cannot rule over. That is not God's system. It is not God's system. A wife should take control, a wife should take authority. In which family the wife takes authority, the wife controls, in that family, the children will not even respect the father. There is no honor and respect for the father where the family is ruled by a wife. That is not God's system. That is not God. You may be multi-talented. You may be highly qualified. If you are a woman being rooted in the word, if God says you to submit, means submit, that's all. This shows the quality, and because of this character, so that even if some do not obey, even if the husband is not rooted in the word, looking at the behavior of the wife, looking at the quality of the wife, looking at the submissive character of her, that man will come into Christ. They may be won over to Christ without discussion by the godly lives of their wives. Only when the woman is being rooted in the word, she will learn. She will learn to be submissive. It is very difficult. It is very, very difficult to you know, you can make the right decision, but you are ready. If you are looking at the verse and say, if you really love Christ, you are immediately submissive to God. Not my opinion, Lord. I'll be a helpmate. I'll give him opinion, but I'm not going to take control. I'm not going to take authority. Looking as a submissive character, even a man who's not rooted in the word, who's not in the kingdom, will see the quality of the wife and accept Christ. This is what happened in Smith Wigglesworth. His wife was rooted in the word. She prioritized God. She was very submissive. But she went to one prayer meeting and happened to come late. Because she was too late, it was in London, I think in UK. It was, the climate was very cold, winter time, snow, heavy snow outside. Because she came late, husband was annoyed with her, kept her to stand outside. She stood outside for the whole night in that cold weather, but she didn't complain, she didn't crumble. She was focused. I think it was God's protection over her. Nothing happened to her. She was submissive. Her focus was only on God. She did not complain and grumble and say, why did he do this to me? I'm praying for him only. You know, I'm sacrificing my life for the family only. You know, and why is he doing this to me? She didn't say. Morning, when he came and opened the door, as if nothing happened, she just came and hugged him and kissed him. And she went to prepare the breakfast as if nothing happened. From where did she get the courage not to speak back, not to fight for her night, not to ask questions? She was submissive to God's word. That gave her the strength to be submissive. And this was the quality. And that night, Smith Wigglesworth was not rooted in the word, dedicated his life to Christ. And from then onwards, because of him, he was a person who raised many of them from deathbed. Miracles, he saw mighty miracles. He used to be a very tough, hard, very hard, strong person in the word of God. He cannot tolerate sickness. He used to speak to the sickness with authority. Tumors disappeared, big tumors disappeared on the stage itself. Healing took place because the wife made a decision to be submissive to God's word, denied herself, allowed Christ to live. Husband recognized the Christ in her, dedicated his life. Even I happened to hear this thing. Some marriages seem to be very good, made for each other, very charm, like a prince and princess, looking very nice outside with all riches and everything. But if there is no Christ, that marriage will not stand. And there is complete brokenness in that marriage. If Christ is not there, seems to be happy, everything perfect, highly educated, both are educated. But if they are not rooted in the word, both of them selfish, both of them self-centered. Why did you do this? Why did you do this? Always arguing, fighting and quarreling. Where there is envy and strife, there is every evil work. Children are being destroyed. Children mindset is destroyed. Children going into depression. Children's going into addiction, drugs. But a marriage that seems to be, how come she married this person or how come he married her, seems to be totally chaos, seem to be, they are not at all made for each other. But if one person is being rooted in, even that worst marriage can become a very bless, can be a blessing, not only a blessing, they'll become a blessing for many others when they take Christ as the center of a happy married life. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Is there anyone want to say anything? You can also add your point. We can ask elders. Sister Lily, would you like to say?
Yes, sister. Yeah, this decision-making, all that... what Bible says is like really hitting me. Like certain times I tend to overrule on like certain decisions, and I see also sometimes it turns out like a negative aspect comes up out of that. So only but that requires a lot of humility also. I am convicted by that word.
Yes, ma'am. No need to go into confirmation.
Yeah.
That is most important.
Yeah.
Even me too, sister. I am also a person who will take the upper hand. And it is also pricking me.
Yeah, because financial decisions and all, He himself says he doesn't know, and sometimes when he does, and certain times when I say this, I rebuke and I say, why you did this, why kind of things. That requires a lot of humility from my side also.
Yes, that.
Thank you. Thank you for this.
Thank you,
thank
sister.
You, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I had listened to this. I don't know who preached, Papa. I don't know who. Allowing the husband to take, we can be an helpmate. We are there to help them. It is not that completely, I'm not involved, not like that. I'm there, I can give suggestion, opinion. But allowing him to take the decision, even if it is wrong, okay, let him learn from the mistake. Allow them to make the decision. Let them also make a mistake. And from that mistake, they will learn, oh, I should not do that. And they will learn from mistake. Sometimes what happens, even not only for spouse, for some parents will not allow their children to take decision. They will think that he will make a wrong decision or she will make a wrong decision. And they will be there pampering them. Even after the age of 40, 50 also, they'll be pampering and going behind the son and the daughter, and they are taking the rulership. No, allow them to take the decision. Let them fail. Let them make a wrong decision. Let them learn from the lesson. Let them fall. And when they fall, they will know how to stand. They will know how to face. They will start to trust God. They will not trust on their talents. Praise Jesus. Praise God. And
yes, that's true also. The children. We can.
Yes, sister. Your voice is breaking.
Need to allow them to go to that extra mile.
Yes. And we are here to help them. We can give them the suggestion, but let them make the decision and let them face the consequences, and they will learn a lesson from that. When the that is the thing. And where God is very clear, the day he created Adam and Eve, Adam and Eve didn't have mother and father. In, I think in Genesis chapter 2, somewhere around 18, I think, it is clearly said that God said, you leave your mother and father, leave your father and mother, and you are united together. And in that case, Adam and Eve did not have father and mother. Now come down, Marita. Somewhere at the last, should be alone. And down 1920, it is not taught, it will come at the bottom only. I think somewhere on La 24. Praise God. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. In this case, Adam and Eve didn't have parents, but God was clear. Even in Papa took this in a marriage, what is it, in this, what is it, series? Godly Marriage. In Godly Marriage series.
Godly Marriage.
Yes. Godly Marriage series, Papa thought about this inside the garden. He said that marriage, after marriage, husband and wife, they become a separate, and that garden becomes separate garden, and that family becomes a separate family. It is not one family, we are all together one. It is Indian mindset, grandmother, grandfather. No, according to God's principle, two families come together. This is the word that Papa said. Two families come together, giving their daughter and their son, and they are allowing to create a third family. It is not that two family come together and become one family. No. Two family come together and providing their children to become another separate family. Help them means give opinion, but you don't take authority what your son should do or what your daughter should do. You don't take the rulership. You don't take the decision. Let them take the decision. Let them take, and if they make any mistake, you can give your opinion. It should be an opinion. It should be a suggestion, but it should not be a command. Praise Jesus. God is very clear. When a verse is coming, the same verse you can see in Ephesians. When a verse is repeated, it is confirmed. It is confirmed. It is must. In case, I said I'll see this verse, I need to take. In case the mother or the father, they are alone, there's no one to help them, a widow or widower, elderly parents. In that case, it is our responsibility to take care of them, to look after them. Even in that case, it is clearly given in God's word, the elderly parents, they are not supposed to interfere with everything that happens in their children's life. They can suggest, they can give opinion, they can give their experience, what they went through, but don't take rulership. Don't take rulership. Praise God. And today, why I took this husband and wife relationship is I'm seeing there is imbalance. They want the children, blessing of the fruit. Their focus is on the child only, but the relationship, because of childlessness for a long period of time, there is a type of separation between husband and wife. There is a misunderstanding between husband and wife. There is a wall between them. Yesterday, I was speaking about one friend. In her case, my concern is towards her husband. What is he going through? She being a person rooted in the word, she need to reflect Christ. But because of the loss, thinking about the loss, making herself go into the shell, completing her whole married life into chaos, into destruction. That is why before wanting a child, prioritize one another. Give importance to one another. God created Adam and Eve to express their love. Expression of love, the fruit of their love is to have children. It's a blessing. But in our case, no need of you, no need of her. I can also go for IVF and I can have a child. It has gone into that extreme. For society, for the namesake of society, we are one family as a husband and wife, but inside there is no union, there is no understanding, and there is complete separation. It is not God's will. If Christ is the center, you will have happy married life. Your children are blessed. Your children will know how your children are learning. Our children are learning from us how to treat our spouse. We are setting, not only our married life is happy, our generation is being blessed. You're setting a model. This is known as a Christian life. Christian life is not getting up every day, going to mass and coming back. Okay, Lord, finish. I heard 3 verses. No. Learning and forgetting means it is not at all. A Christian life is to reflect Christ in our life, especially in marriage. Praise Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I think I can stop here. We can continue next class. Anything else? Malta, would you like to say anything? Chamita? Anu?
Yes, Asin, and I remember one wisdom ki Papa always tells Shad, and uncommon things give the uncommon reward. That incident you told, that wife stand all day that night, and after that a lot of changes in her husband's life. So always the uncommon things, no need to justify ourselves, no need to open ourselves, and don't get into the argument. Without argument, we do that uncommon things, always get that uncommon results, uncommon rewards. The one thing I always remember, I always focus this, and whatever is going on, we focus only Christ. We focus only God. Be patient, be peace with God, and everything surrendered, submit to God, and automatically that whatever it will come, that is come. That, yes, uncommon things always give that uncommon reward. True. Relationship also, when that quarrel will come, we highlight ourselves, pride, and so at the time we focus more of you, Jesus, less of me, and at the time the relationship is smooth, and we dominate ourselves, we always think about I give more priority myself, and we always think about our side. At the time only the quarrel will come, that our point of self only, we always mostly the Satan give the pressure, the focus on my ourself. Okay, so that time only the quarrel begins. The thought running in our mind, that at the time we identify and then pulling down, and then catch the thought, and then give that word of God and speak the word of God, open our mouth and speak the word of God, and then one or two lines, there's more of you, Jesus, less of me. So we remember at that time that that emotions not rule over my life, and I control our emotions, we control our emotions. So that time that relationship is smooth. So only thing, Christ is center in our marriage. Whatever the problem, the triangle should be remind the two sides, and then whatever the part, this side the problem, that we surrender to God, and then automatically this side is balanced.
True, true. What yes. You said is true. And yes. When the focus shifts on Christ, it will also repent, and we'll make a correction. What you said is right.
Yes.
Yes, God. Thank you, Mata. That uncommon. I will not forget that uncommon.
Yes, uncommon. We always justify ourselves. No. So our point of self only, we always think about this is, think about, we always think uncommon things. This uncommon means this is, let it be uncommon. Uncommon things always give that uncommon reward. Don't need to praise ourselves. So we always praise our glorify God and focus God, what kind of pain he go through. So think about that thing, and then our relationship with God will extend, and our relationship with family also, it will.
Yes, Jesus.
is easy to preach, but this practical application is very difficult. And then the quarrel that that time only we always every morning we always think about these kind of keys and the daily one keys and then they apply. Gives that tremendous result.
That is why we need to be 24/7 rooted in the world.
Yes. Once we need to charge our battery every day. Without battery, the mobile will not work. So the same way, we need to charge ourselves. Out of the abundance, come out of our mouth. So what is inside your heart? What is inside your mind? What is thinking? What do you think all the time? You think about your problem, think about your relationship, and then only that come out of our mouth. So we change our focus, think of, fill your heart with the word of God, take one promises or one or five promises and think it. And Joseph always tells that take the one scriptures and squeeze it and juice it and take the juice of that. So that the same way, one scriptures and repeatedly take any scripture related to your situation. And keep on thinking, keep on pondering. That is, word of God is power and active. So really, it will work. We meditate. Most of the time, we meditate on a problem. She do like this. She behave like this. And he behave like this. Whatever. We think about one particular person. At that time, surely the Holy Spirit will come and guide us. And this is wrong. At that time, we need to aware and then come out of that thought, come out of negative emotions. So the word of God only that solution. Meditate the word of God.
Praise Jesus.
Thank you, Aslin. It's nice. The teaching is very nice. Yesterday also very nice. Today also the relationship, marriage, very nice.
Yes, this is more important now. Having child, they are going into action and forgetting the relationship.
Yes.
Praise God. Thank you. Chamita said something.
Thank you.
Chamita had put something. I think the same amount. Okay. She for an internet issue. Okay. Okay.
Okay. Bye, Aslin. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you, Marita.
I don't want to say anything. I didn't ask Okay. Thank you all. Thank you so much. Bye.
Thank you all. Bye. God bless you. Tomorrow no class, then?
Tomorrow no class. We can put this as premium 6 o'clock one and
okay. Okay.
Thank you, Marika.
Thank you.
Today you can put one.